choice. When we choose, be man or woman enough to say, this was my choice. We choose candidates. We choose careers. We choose companions. Let's own our decisions and stop putting the onus on God. Folk will complain about decisions they made, and then to make themselves feel off the hook, say, I don't know why God led me to do this. That's your decision. And you either need to deal with your decision and make the best out of it, or acknowledge it was a bad decision, but stop putting the responsibility on God. Rome would declare and believe that it was God's will that he be elected, but he wasn't. He used scripture and biblical metaphor to affirm that it was God's will, but apparently it wasn't. If you want to run, that's your right. But stop saying it's God's will so that those who are part of the Christian community will feel like they've got to make a choice between you and God and Satan and the other candidate. Many people declare and believe that God gave me my spouse. Hallelujah. I prayed and asked God, show me the one. When I saw them, I felt something in my shoulder. That let me know they were the one. And they walked down the aisle, made their vows, and the first sign of trouble, they'll say, they turned their back on God, and God told me I ain't have to stay. Now you chose to get in, now you're choosing to get out, but you don't want to take responsibility. You want to say God led you. Stop putting that on God. That's your choice. Some people choose well, some don't. Own your decision. Some marriages succeed, some don't. But own your decision. That's not God, that's you. Praying doesn't make it God ordained. In the text, they pray, Lord, which one of these two? He quoted scripture. Use it out of context, but quote scripture doesn't make it spiritual. Amen. Folk do that all the time. And you know I get it as a preacher because they think they're going to impress me because they quote scripture. Bible says. Just because you quoting a scripture doesn't mean God has ordained it. All right. If it's your choice, own it. You wanted that car. God blessed me with the car, and then it's repossessed. Tell me the devil got in this. No, you chose to buy the car. Own it. There's nothing wrong with you saying, I made this decision. I regret the decision I made because we learn more from our mistakes than we learn from what we do right. That's one of the reasons why I love biographies of great people. Nelson Mandela is held highly as a great man, but in his young days, he was a rolling stone. He made mistakes. His wisdom came from the lessons he learned from his mistakes. But you can't learn if you're putting the responsibility and blame on God. Own your decision and learn from your decision. How do you make the right choice? Well, first of all, you've got to identify your life's mission. What is your life's mission? And decide based on that mission. If your decision hinders your mission, it's a bad choice. If your decision benefits your mission, it may be a good choice. Sometimes you don't see whether it's a benefit or a hindrance until after you make the decision. But own it. We make good decisions, we make bad decisions, but maturity teaches us to take ownership of it. I told you before, when I was in college, when I started college, I didn't go to parties. God was dealing with me on preaching. I started preaching my freshman year. I was preaching in places I had never heard of. I was getting calls from pastors I had never heard of to preach. I was preaching multiple times every Sunday. I flunked out not because of the club. I flunked out because of church. But at the end of the day, I still flunked out. Now, in them days, I said, God, I've been doing your work. And you let this happen to me? But y'all, you can't pass biology from studying Genesis. And so whatever your decision, own your decision, it's yours. Which says then, number two, don't be in a rush to decide. They chose Matthias. But one day, sometime later, a young man who didn't fit Peter's criteria was on his way to Damascus. And he was knocked to the ground. A voice thundering from the heavens, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? He didn't fit Peter's description so much so that he had to ask, who are you? Jesus says, it's the Lord whom you persecute. The Lord blinded him physically until he could get some spiritual insight. And Saul became God's choice as the 12th apostle. Now that's not conjecture. If I'm wrong, Paul was wrong. Because Romans 1 and 1, Paul refers to himself as an apostle called to be a servant separated unto the gospel. In 1 Corinthians 1 and 1, he identifies himself as Paul called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. In Galatians 1 and 1, he opens the epistle as Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ. That seems to be a reason he put that part in. He wanted to know, I wasn't called because somebody cast lots. I was called because Jesus himself spoke to me. Talked to me after Calvary. Talked to me after the resurrection. Talked to me after his ascension. He got my undivided attention. He called me, and I didn't fit Peter's criteria, but I'm still God's choice. They rushed because working for God is often easier than waiting on God. If you're going to make some good choices, you're going to have to read some books other than the Bible.
All right. All right. Amen.
The Bible is not going to help you make real estate choices. Come on, help me, somebody. The Bible is not a manual for every subject. The Bible is a manual that discloses the heart of God. So that when you see the heart of God through the character of Jesus Christ, you can be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. But the Bible was not written to answer every question for you. Those who misuse the Bible this way represent those who represent that crowd of those who are so heavenly minded they're no earthly good. They talk all holy all the time, sound all spiritual, and if you really process what they're saying, they make no sense. They sound spiritual, but unsaved folk will not be one to Christ through them because they're irrational. And so, you've got to read some stuff other than the Bible. You've got to find people who've made choices on the matter that you're wrestling with and get some advice from them. It's just wise to invest in yourself. One way you invest in yourself is you find people who can give you some solid advice and listen. Sometimes that's difficult to do because you get around people that's wise and you feel threatened. So you talk to show them how wise you are. And you've heard that quote that it's better to sit quiet and look like a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. Find somebody who can advise you. Take them out to lunch. Sometimes our paradigm is off. We're like, but they've got more money than me. I ain't paying for their lunch. One man said that if he lost his job and only had $3, he would go to an expensive coffee shop, use that $3 to buy some coffee, and strike up a conversation with somebody who had some money, and ask them, now what do I do next? If you can get life-changing advice for $3, it's worth the investment. They rushed because they wanted to show that they were ready to move forward. But sometimes you have to contemplate before you activate. It's better to wait and be right than to rush and be wrong. For 20 years, 1997 to 2017, the Alabama United States Senator was Jeff Beauregard Sessions. President Donald Trump appointed him as the Attorney General of the United States. And because of this appointment, it opened up this opportunity where we now have a Democrat as the United States Senator. If he had just left Sessions there, we still have a Republican now. But because he acted, his actions opened up an opportunity that he did not want to turn out the way it had. God is the only one who can take a crooked stick and hit a straight leg. That's why sometimes you just gotta wait and be still, because God may not be coming through your front door to ring your doorbell. He might be coming through the back window, but if he says he's coming, I guarantee you, he's on the way. Amen. That leads to my final point. God can use bad decisions for good. Somebody here today can testify to that. That you made some choices and you owned your choice and it was not a good decision, but you owned it, and God turned your bad decision into a good result. David made a bad decision when he saw Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, and he took her as his own, and he ended up having Uriah killed. It was a bad decision, but God used that union to bring a Solomon. God can take your bad decision and create something good out of it. Joseph had betraying brothers who sold him off, but God used that so that when they needed liberation, Joseph was in position to be God's instrument towards their liberation. God can use your bad decision and produce a bad outcome. Matthias was not God's choice, but yet he did do some preaching. History records that he did some preaching. He didn't do what Paul did. Paul wrote over half the New Testament. But he did some preaching. God can use our bad choices to produce some good out of it. We make mistakes. We make bad choices. We attribute the decision that we make to God. But when we mess up, we need to know that God can take our messes and mix it with his mercy. He can take our rubbish and make it his rubies. He can take our shame and use it for his own shine. He can take our disgrace and transform it into his amazing grace. He can take our sin and reveal to us his salvation. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. There were some folk one day who made some terrible decisions. They arrested Jesus and crucified Jesus, but God used their bad decision so that their bad decision would be the formula for my salvation. Oh yes, you're human. You're going to make some bad decisions. Don't hang around folk too much. That, number one, reminds you constantly of your bad decisions. And then, number two, don't hang around folk too long who act like they ain't never made no bad decisions.